So I just wanted to let you know that the recording has now begun. The light has been lit. So I am super excited that Jason is here with us today. We're going to do a couple different things because Jason is not usually someone who easily is able to engage in this because he's really good at what he does. So thanks, Jason, for being awesome at what you do. And thank you for being willing to spend an hour with us. But we didn't make a big deal that he was here. We snuck it through a few channels, but we were like, Jason may be able to make it. At the same time, because life happens, we are going to spend a little bit of time with Lisa and I going over Advent at home and what that kind of can look like and what those options are for you all to share with others. So this is our time just to kind of hang out with one another and to share the amazing resources and things that are happening. And since Heather Reed is also here, I will give her a little bit of time to share, but more than likely I will be making her share more in the future. So if all of a sudden you get really interested in what Heather's about to say, because she's here, which you should, we will continue to help support her in that amazing work as well. So with all of that being said, Jason, are you willing just to say hi and share a little bit about, like, I know enough about your personality to go, you can kind of hang with us. We're mostly people on this call are throughout all the country. These are the Disciples of Christ, Christian church people who celebrate in all different ways of trying to make sure that we do church innovatively with our young people and have conversation of what that looks like. A lot of your work has inspired me, including the Intergenerate book and a lot of your keynotes and leadership and even your thoughts around the different generations. So share a little bit, because I know you're now in Colorado.
Yes.
In wildfire or snow section, they go kind of back and forth. And share just a little bit about, for those, let's pretend, I mean, there are those on this call who totally know who you are and some of your work and are so just awesome. And then there are some on this call who have no idea who you are and really will be impressed to know you create amazing games. You're an amazing gamer.
I don't know about that, but well, thank you for that kind introduction. My name is Jason Santos. I am ordained Presbyterian minister for, I guess I just celebrated my 10th year in my ordination, but I've been in ministry most of my life. I was raised Methodist and then Assemblies of God for a good chunk of my life until sort of my mid-20s, and then ended up at Wheaton grad school studying theology and became a Calvinist and sort of found my way to the Presbyterian church that way. But I have a background in youth ministry, both professionally and educationally. I did a PhD in the early, I started in around 2010, 2012. And it was on youth and young adult spirituality. And it was in the process of really trying to figure out how to manage the hemorrhaging that we're experiencing in the church. It led me to sort of say, hey, this is a much larger problem than youth ministry. And it led me little by little to this idea of intergenerational formation. The more I studied identity formation, how we develop a sense of self, how we develop patterns and practices, the more I realized that I think internally that so many of the things that had defined my vocation were contributing to the fragmentation of our church and our culture, not into drawing us together. So I embarked on doing intergenerational stuff, around 2010, and got 11 months, actually 10 years ago, I applied to this church that I'm at now, which is in the mountains of Colorado. I'm in a town of 400, about an hour from south of Gunnison. I live in the most remote county in the lower 48 states. We drive an hour and 15 minutes to go to a grocery store, but it's a little retirement town, about 8,700 foot elevation. We're a trailhead town. But I applied here, didn't end up, because I wanted to come here and write my dissertation, but I ended up in a big church in Seattle, a big Presbyterian church, 4,200 members. I was in charge of the youth ministry. And 11 months into it, they forcibly fired me, in a large part because I was trying to do intergenerational stuff and trying to break down some of those walls of this massive age and state. It was like writ large. So, and then I ended up in a small Amish country, small town in Western Pennsylvania, and kind of healed and really dug into the whole notion of intergenerationality. And that's where this book, I'm sure you're all familiar with it. It was in 2012 that this book came out. And it was like this, it was like everything that I was wrestling and trying to put together in my head in one volume. And it really sort of, and then it kind of gave me a framework to really think a little bit more concretely about it. And from there, I was there about 2.5 years and then ended up in the national offices of the Presbyterian Church, where I oversaw Christian formation as a whole for the denomination, and intergenerationality really became sort of a central push of that whole thing. So in my time there, and now I'm in a town where there's again 400, and I have a church of mostly over 65 year olds. I've come here to write, but also to answer the question, what do you do when you're a small church and you don't have any kids naturally there? I mean, I'm facing the problem that many pastors are facing. So I look forward to sort of tackling that. So that's my introduction. I am, you know, intergenerational formation stuff is new to all of us. We're all experimenting, and I consider my, whenever I taught this stuff for the denomination, at the end, people will always say, well, give us what we can do. And I would always be hesitant because I really, we haven't developed best practices, really. We're just sort of trying to figure that out. So one thing I like to always say, if you're experimenting with intergenerational formation, recognize that there isn't a whole lot to go off of. And as long as you're getting some point of intergenerational intersection, you're probably doing better than most. So
can you also tell us a little bit about the games you create, just because that's fun?
Sure. I didn't grow up a gamer, and I'm not a huge video gamer, but when I lived in Germany for a year back in the early 2000s and played in, on a church retreat, someone pulled out this game with all of these hexagon tiles and put it together to form an island. And then he said, welcome to the world of Catan. And my life was literally changed that night. It led to an obsession with board game. I mean, it was like my mind exploded. And so I now have about a 400 and some collection board game collection that I host in our, I've taken an office in one of the other church buildings and made it into a game library. But I started designing games, I don't know, about a decade ago, just out of liking the thought process. I mean, as a practical theologian, I put different systems of thought together, theology, psychology, sociology, anthropology, and I kind of ask how they all intersect. And game development is kind of the same thing. You are putting together different mechanics and things together, seeing how they fit, putting a theme over them. And I got fascinated just with the whole process of design, the mechanic, the balance, and then putting the theme and the aesthetics on top of it. So I use my job in the National Office of the Presbyterian Church to produce a few card games along the way. I did a college one where I put myself on a card. Yeah, see, that's me. And then I did a camp version of it. And then we did a whole different one called At Church. And actually, I think they still, Olivia, you know Stephanie Fritz, right?
I know who she is. I don't know her very well.
I'll connect you up. If you all are interested, this is actually an intergenerational game where all the different generations are represented by different colors. And when you play, and then there's the Christian practices in the corner as a suit. And the goal of it is the highest scoring hand that you can have in it is when you have five different generations doing the same Christian practice suit. So, but you don't, we don't say that, it's just sort of embedded in it. So we're sort of up, the idea was is to uplift intergenerational formation as the ultimate without actually having it be overt. So, but they have a bunch of these. If you want some, I'm sure she'd send you some.
I have the camp ones. I took a few of them and then I sometimes spread them out when I'm at camp things because everybody enjoys that. It's a quality get to know that counselor night when you're first sitting around going, who are these people that are engaging this week?
And that's what it's designed together to do, is it's really designed to break down those. And I will say that I've in recent years crisscrossed my gaming world, which I dug into more of a theology of play. When I was in the denomination office, I had more money to play with. So I ran a couple of theology of play conferences and just did some stuff around gaming and obviously developed some games. But intergenerationally, I think playing board games is one of the singular most genuinely intergenerational activities we can participate in, even more than worship. And not that worship shouldn't be that way, but like you can have a 7-year-old and a 27-year-old and a 47-year-old and a 77-year-old all playing a game of Dinosaur Tea Party. And every single one of those people playing has the exact same chance of winning. And there is just a leveled mutuality and reciprocity and interaction there that occurs that you don't have in an active way, where adults still have that capacity to demonstrate good behavior and their sportsmanlike behavior when they play. But also just to have a kid be able to beat an adult in something and have that not be, oh, I let them win, or it was inconsequential anyways. So
my daughter just got ordered Ark. My husband's playing this game, this computer game Ark, where you tame dinosaurs and dodos virtually with his friends. And she has now gotten her own version and she's so excited about being able to play with the guys.
Is that ARC?
I think, look, I'm the mom. I play Mario. I mean, I'm a gamer, but I'm just old school. I'm not intense, but yeah. I think it's ARC. But she's so excited to virtually, and she's 7. She's like, Mom, I trained a dodo. I named it McDonald's. I'm like, great. Okay.
I actually heard about this, though, Olivia. Someone recently, I think, mentioned, I think this is what it is. It's some online platform that you use Zoom or somehow is this kind of a Zoom type platform where you, and they were talking about it in relationship to intergenerational connection. So
that's amazing. So who knew? I'll tell my husband, he's doing quality intergenerational work totally by accident up there.
You know, one last thing I'll say about the games is that since I've been here at this church, I've led online games, mm-hmm. which sound odd, but there are these, this is one of them just happens to be next to me. This is called Welcome To. But they're called roll and rights, where this is actually a flip and write, but same principle of mm-hmm. you're rolling or you're flipping cards and you're producing a result. And then everyone has to take that result and on their own player sheets at their house and their own home, what they've downloaded off the, you know, off the web and printed it out. They are filling out like a sheet like this. And you're just putting numbers in these and trying to put them in ascending order and scoring different things down here. All that's to say is for about 5 months, I've been leading an intergenerational gaming group on Monday nights. And I always extend the welcome to all to join us. So if you're interested in seeing how an online game is run, you can find all that stuff on our church website.
I know. I'm like, yes, I finally get a game night. Thursday night, my house is game night, and I'm not allowed to engage.
And this week, so Lake City www.lakecitypresbyterian.org, which is just, I live in Lake City, and it's the only Presbyterian church here, so. And tonight we're actually playing at 7 o'clock Mountain Time. Anyone can join. I explain and clarify questions for like the first 15 minutes. We've had people from all over the country. Typically we have about a half a dozen regular gamers, maybe 8 of them that will show up and play. Beyond that, we always have random people who just pop in and try one game or not, but we're on our like 8th game. But tonight, and if you go to that, and there's something at the top called the menu says games up here. And in that, it'll have the player sheet for the game we're playing tonight. And if you scroll all the way to the bottom, because this was the first one of that games up here page, there is a instruction video for how to play But tonight we're playing the Winter Wonderland version. So if you want to join us 7 o'clock Mountain Time, you're more than welcome to. And if nothing else, you'll see how it functions and works. But I have about a dozen roll and write games, and next week I'll teach a new one, and every few weeks we teach a new one.
That's awesome. For a long time we were storing a life-size version of Settlers of Catan in our house that's played year. My husband goes to what I call his not real fraternity, and it is an intergenerational group of about 60 people who meet for a weekend every year and play online computer games, board games, and engage, and they've done that for like 15 years. Because we do have limited time, and
sorry,
we're all having a good time. I do want to also ask you to share just a little bit about what happened with Chris Barnett, just because I think it's interesting for people to know how he called people from out the world. Sometimes when we talk about our ministry and our intergenerational, we think of it as just the United States, and as disciples, we'll sometimes include Canada, but just talk a little bit about what is happening and that connection, since you're connected into that.
Yeah, so I'm going to put this, someone asked for there's the link to the church. And then you have to go to the menu, just click games up here. So in May of 2018, I guess it would have been 18, because it would have been 18, 19, we're in 20 now. So no, 2019, sorry. A guy named Chris Barnett, who is from Australia, decided to put together just a group of a couple folks from each country who were working on intergenerational stuff, who had been writing about it or speaking about it. And so I was among that group that has now been dubbed as the Westminster 20, because we met on Westminster. We met at the national offices of the Church of England, which are in the Westminster complex in London. And so we met there for about, 48, 72 hours, something like that. And really it was, so Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, UK, Canada, and the US were all represented. And it was kind of a chance to sort of say what is actually happening, and a recognition of where our similarities and differences were. Largely, you could argue that we were all Western countries, so we were all kind of dealing with this similar fragmentation of our culture, and I think that was probably the most thing we had in common, and that's been one of the challenges that we all faced and recognized, was there was this, in a day and age where we're talking more about multicultural or ethnic churches or multi-ethnic churches, intergenerationality does not really fit that as perfectly as really, because it's as much as there's an issue there in terms of gradual fragmentation. I would say predominantly white culture, Western culture, has a tendency to fragment sooner because of individualism, and it's not as much in collective cultures. I'm half Filipino, so I grew up with sort of seeing this dichotomy writ large in terms of holiday vacations, we'd go, and the Filipino side was very collective, but the white side wasn't, and I think that fragmentation is what we're seeing across the globe, but particularly and most acutely I think here in the U.S. but in large part because so many of the resources that the Western world uses, and I mean all those global countries uses, they rely on our resources. One of the biggest complaints the Australians had was like, you all, make Easter this big sunny beautiful thing that it's new spring, and they're entering into their winter, and it's, so they're completely opposite us. So their Easter is entering into darkness and to colder months, and so it's just, but they still have to adapt all these resources. So we're kind of I think we're recognizing, I think we're at a place where in this conversation, and again, I said, this is a very new conversation. Holly Allen, one of the, I guess we call her the godmother of intergenerational stuff, but she and I wrote a journal article over the summer for the Journal of Christian Education, tracing the last 40 years of intergenerationality. And we see, and really kind of, I think it was about the point where we started to realize, when we started to separate more and more in our church ministry lives, we started to see faith development a little differently because we're putting different ages and stages here and there, that these same authors that they started the, you know, that sort of started the base of this conversation around the notion of holistic formation, of communal formation rather than in, you know, pod or segmented formation. And I think that they set the stage for what happened really around the year 2000, when we started to really identify the fact that young people were not staying in the church. And it was the first time we turned a microscope back on the whole age and stage paradigm and said, is this working? And through the last 20 years or so, I think it's grown. I mean, you know, I think there are people doing intergenerational stuff in the first half of the past of, you know, in 2000 to 2010. But I don't think it was really a conversation really until that book came out. I think that sort of coalesced. And then, and so it should be no surprise that the Intergenerate Conference that happened in 2017 and then 2019, it was supposed to happen again this year, but COVID probably won't have it happen. But that conversation stems out of Holly's work and organization. And that's how you got connected, I believe, right, Olivia?
Yeah, I got connected in through that team. I'm no longer a part of that team just due to a lot of things. And then I always joke that Melissa Cooper is kind of like the Methodist version of me. So you don't really need us both. We both have dark hair and glasses. And I'm like, you've got the Methodist version. It's fine. Just stick with Melissa and it'll be okay. She'll let me know what happened at this time, because some of my struggle has been the intersectionality of intergenerational. We have, as disciples, we work really hard to really have quality conversation both around racism and ageism. And Holly openly will say she is not that is not where her heart is intergenerationally within a certain framework. And my heart is moving towards trying to have a little bit more of that framework. So, and that actually is an amazing segue. So that segues right over to you, Heather. Did you realize that was coming your direction? Because a big part of what we are doing, and you can even still see on the screen, I mean, we are predominantly white because many of our associates and many of the people who are involved, but the Ministries Across Generations team does have quite a bit of intentionality to make sure that we have representatives from OBRA, from our national convocation, but we continue to try to figure out the best ways to have those conversations. And so it's hard sometimes, because a lot of times those conversations still are generationally heavy in one section. I've noticed that quite a bit when I'm in meetings with general level church, is I'm still the young adult and I'm not that young. And yet when you have conversations with younger people, so we don't know how to have reconciliation conversations well, and we don't know how to have them intergenerationally at all. And yet we all know we're being forced back into that. But I do want to then remind you that Kate and I have put together Talking to Kids About the Poor People's Campaign. There's going to be a huge push that's coming out. It is all online and ready to go. Obviously, the Poor People's Campaign is focused on the vote, but Adam Barnes, who has been working with us through Kairos Ministry, once the prophetic council is ready to go forward, and Kate has been doing a lot to advertise with Sherilyn. I will put that link in continued in the chat. If you got your sign for My Family and Faith, it's for Black Lives Matter. I have to say, I've been doing the back of the 7K, and it's, my kids are rocking my world with that. I didn't realize when I looked at the Disciples Justice page and had to actually explain that candle is lit every day for the children who are separated from their parents, how my son had to process that. He drew an amazing picture to take his time to really process what that meant to him, or making my daughter actually tell her friend what she is doing with her family. and even going to some of the videos and the different things. And then we wrote letters to one of our NBA justice ministries that's in Kentucky, with Dean Bucalis and their church they have for women. So there's some powerful things on the back of that 7K. If you never saw the back of the virtual 7K and you need it, it's over now. So I will send you the image without any question and you can use it to have quality conversation. We did raise $1,500 for Reconciliation Ministry. Heather, however, though, has been rocking it out in Texas. And so I would love for you to take a minute just to share what that experience was like, because the emails I got were amazing. But what's also interesting is we're now doing Echo the Story with my entire church virtually on Zoom, which is also really fun. So playing in all of these sun areas and throwing a lot of ideas out there. Heather, please share for just a second.
Well, when we realized that reconciliation was not really being focused towards our youth, and those conversations were kind of hard to have, here in the Southwest region, we decided we really needed to do something about it. And so probably in July or August, we started having conversations about how we would tackle that subject and decided to put on a seminar that we actually had in October last month, hoping that we would have 30 people register for this seminar to sit in small groups and have discussions and have a small keynote. Within the first 72 hours, I had to shut down registration with over 100 registrations. And the conversations were phenomenal. We met every Sunday night from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Central Time. Yvonne Gilmore, which is part of the convocation, and she is she's our associate.
She is my favorite sermon ever.
Yeah,
ever.
She was our keynote leader, and the kids really responded. We went ahead and did from 6th grade to 12th grade. We did middle school and high school, but when we broke them out into groups, we split them between the two age groups, and then we had them meet in the same groups each week. So they built relationships. They had that closeness and felt at ease opening and sharing with one another. It went so well, and the kids responded so wonderfully that we're doing it again in January. Yvonne's already agreed to do it in January. And we've decided now that we're going to open it up even more, and we're going to open it to the general church, not to just the Southwest region. So we're going to start promoting it throughout the general church. And then we've decided to take it a step further. So we're not only going to be doing a Dismantling Racism in January, but each quarter we're going to do a different ism. So we're going to do racism in January. We're going to do sexism the second quarter. We're going to do ageism in the third quarter. And in the fourth quarter, we're doing unity and how we all come together and bring that back together in home. And so we're really excited. We're going to start getting some materials out. Love for any ideas or thoughts to come our way. If you have any ideas or want to participate, I'll put my email down in the chat area. Get in contact with me. We're the small group leaders that we've had. We're using people within each of the regions or in our areas. The only requirement we're having for the Dismantling Racism training, is that you have already gone through the reconciliation training yourself and already have that certificate before you become part of the small group leaders. But that being said, we also had a group of about 30 adults during this last racism training that got trained, because since Yvonne is also a certified trainer, it counts as their reconciliation training also. And so now we have those adults that can come out and help us in small groups too. But it was a good push, and it was a good time to get our youth ministers and our children's ministers into reconciliation and on board. So we're excited. Things are going really well here in the Southwest region, and we're wanting to tackle some things, not just here in the region anymore. We want to go globally. So,
and we are here to help you do that. And the Refugee and Immigration Virtual Mission Trip is still online. And
it is still online.
Go Texas. So, and celebrate Heather and all she's working. I will show you some bits and pieces of that, because I would get the emails and the paperwork and the insight is just amazing. And so already today I've emailed Yvonne and talked to Heather to be like, I'm ready to kumbaya as we move forward. And Kate will also want to join in on that with her passion for justice and her work. So there's just some great ways to really connect that. And I just want to celebrate that because I saw it out there and was like, way to go. With all that coming, obviously we also have Advent, and Lisa actually is like many of us doing double things. So you can see she has her little setup over there going. I'm going to give her to the floor now for just a few minutes. And then when she has to go, I will show you where some of the free stuff is with this, along with the other ideas as you seek to find ways to do Advent at home and in church and with what we put together with these pieces. So Lisa, it is your turn.
All right. Can you hear me? My connection was bad earlier. Good? Okay.
Yes.
I can't see you very well because my screen is pointed down to the ground. So so when you get this packet, and I believe Olivia is going to make some of these stories available on our website so that you can download the stories if you need them.
I updated it today. They're all on the front page and they're all free.
Okay. So the kit is something that we put together for families at home to do together. And it is an Advent journey that will go over 7 weeks. She included these little guide cards that will also have some faith at home, get ready to worship at home ideas. And her, in collaboration with an illustrator, worked through some really great characters to help families understand different things about the liturgical year, how to practice faith. Each character has a little point that they want to help you talk about sacred. So these are fun little character cards that we have created with to go with the kit to help families kind of have a little fun and humor as we move toward all of our journeys that we have been working on and creating. This has a 7 week, like we talked about. We always like to talk about how to get ready for a church year. And what is our church year? But we start out in Advent talking about the liturgical calendar. And here is her booklet, How the Church Tells Time. And it comes with the activity of a church year calendar on cardstock. Will you make this one? Are you making the cardstock church year? Is that part of it? That is part of
it,
right?
Yes, you can print that out.
You can print that out. Now the rest is all felt. And you can create your own journeys. If any of you have worked with Worship and Wonder, Children Worship and Wonder, this is really an inspiration from the Advent Journey from the Young Children in Worship book. We have adapted and used our own words to create these stories. So we start out with our first week with being the prophets, and we lay our prophet triangle down and we start creating our wreath. So these could all be created. You can use templates from the Young Children in Worship book to help create these. And then we also have beautiful candles out of felt that we add to our wreath. So for the first week we'll be prophets. And the prophet joins us on the road to Jerusalem. And we start and we'll move our characters Bethlehem, as we move our characters to the final day. And here's the other booklet about the prophets. And so all the other weeks are similar. The second one is in an envelope that will, is Elizabeth, the pregnant Elizabeth. And then Elizabeth joins us on the journey. The prophets and Elizabeth, and we add a candle each week. The third week, we will have the Holy Family, Mary and Joseph. They're on their way to Bethlehem. I keep saying Jerusalem, with their donkey. And the next week is the shepherds. And let me just show you the little booklet really quickly. It has an activity for you to do in as a family. And then here's the story that you will follow. to tell about the journey to Bethlehem. And then here's some more prompts to do as a family through critical thinking and wondering together. And I forgot to pull my shepherd guy out, but here is prophet, Elizabeth, holy family, shepherds. And then we are all at Bethlehem. We change out our purple to white. We'll have a full Advent wreath as we are made our way here. And we'll greet baby Jesus, our Christ child, at Bethlehem. That takes us to Christmas. And then we have one more week that we have added, our Epiphany week, with the star over Bethlehem. And we have the three Magi. And then we have the boy Jesus, who they meet at Bethlehem. And here is our story. So that tells you a little bit about the Advent journey that we've put together. Again, you can use the books, the little booklets that we've put down and made available on the, online. Does anybody have anything that want me to add or have any questions about this?
That was just Advent on Zoom. Zoom. Yep.
On Zoom, really quickly. Yep. Oh, you, and you will get in the kit, you get a little candle. But we're trying to reach out to Sally and see if she can make these available for to order if you still feel like that. If you weren't able to get into the pre-order for it, Sally has a link on her website for this activity. So. It's Worship Woodworks is the resource where we got all the materials from.
So with that being said, I will actually then take over.
Okay.
And share my screen, which always scares me because you never know what's coming up. Oh, good. It's the front page. Woo. So you can see the free Faith at Home stories, and you can use them at church. My church this year is actually going to use them. I'm not sure if we're in the building or not, but this way the kids can put the pieces together. But if you click on any of them, they will download. The characters are obviously from my children's books, but then you're able to print them off if you would like. And then you can see that you will probably want to print off How the Church Tells Time on cardstock. One of the things that we wanted to do is, while we want to support the amazing ministry that Sally does with us with Worship Woodworks, we wanted to also make sure that if you're not able to spend that much money per family, there were still ways for different options for families. So if you look here, you can see that all the stories are here, and by watching kind of what Lisa did, you can also see what you may or may not need. You can make your own Advent wreath from them as well. And then we do have our other Advent resources if you're just kind of brainstorming and searching through things. One of the ones I want to continue to lift up, though, if you're looking as a whole church, is an unexpected gift that was put together by Andrew Moran and Suzanne Castle. That is what I'm using with my smaller church because we don't know whether we'll be in or out of the building, but they really put a lot of the pieces together to help us walk through that. You can also see there is the Christmas Mission Project for cards and a ways to reach out that was put together. Our October meeting had Corey with us. And so if you want to watch the other meetings, they are still there. So all of those resources are there. But I do also want to show you under leaders, because we all know that we all work part-time and we're all figuring it out. Sometimes I do not get everything updated. So these are some of the primary publishers. So if you're all of a sudden just like, where do I go? And I need new Advent resources, and Olivia's list has not been updated, or we've already done that 12 times, this is kind of a good place to just go and start and remind yourself of some of the primary resource places that come from most of the mainline denominations. So if you go to our own Chalice Press, you can see that Tracy Smith's Faithful Families for Advent and Christmas is on here, if that is something that you are interested in continuing as well. And then you also have just different options as you look at things. So I wanted to let you know that was there so that when I'm behind, you are aware of what else is out there as we move forward. Also, Illustrated Ministry continues to be an amazing resource. And so we highlight that as we figure out ways to engage. I'm obsessed with Oriental Trading. But I just bought a little Bethlehem item for my little church kids on it. So that since we didn't buy, my family bought the box for at home, but since my church did not, we plan to print out the stories. So I did a little Oriental Trading shopping, as we all did. Also, Sarah is going to be updating, which I really appreciate. She's like, this is great. Can I use this? And I was like, I don't even remember putting it together. So of course you could use it. I think it was like 8 years ago now that I put it together. And there are also the Advent videos. But this is our time where our families are together, and this is the intergenerational moment. And these pieces are really simple, but it's just to help create faith at home. And you can also use these same pieces within worship. So if there's anything you need, you know I'm here. And then once Sarah updates it to make the thing I wrote 8 years ago to make it better, I will post the updated version as well. What do you all need? What is going on from you all that to help you as we move into this time? I know, obviously, everything's crazy. Great. We'll just acknowledge that, and then we will breathe, and then we will know we're together. And then we will go virtual shopping to make ourselves feel better. I mean, no, that's just me. So what do you all need as we continue to connect these resources? Is there anything or anything you want to share? You know, I'm trying to be like Illustrated Ministry, Brim is awesome, Advent at Home, buy some stuff over here, make it work, people. But what do you need? Uh-oh, Shannon's typing.
I have a question about the games that we were just shown. Obviously, I don't think we can buy them on the church website. Where do we buy them? Is Ms. Reverend Santo still on this call?
I am. Sorry, I didn't know if you were talking about which games, the ones that I flashed.
But you're using it at your church.
They would be if Olivia writes Stephanie Fritz at the national office. She was the person who took over for my stuff. She has the at church. They still have some. I don't know what their supply is of the other games, but yeah, you can get those. I mean, Olivia, you probably could. I mean, you either could you could give them the address of the national office and write them. I don't know if they would send out just one deck to someone, but if you want to.
You're talking about Presby USA.
Yeah. But I think, Olivia, if you sent Stephanie an email and said, could you send me a couple dozen of those games? I'm sure she would. I mean, we printed them as giveaways. So.
Okay, awesome. Cool. Yeah, because those are great. I mean, again, during this time of virtual creativity, you know. Wow, you've got some good stuff there.
Well, Diana, who just left, is usually our double date for You Don't Know Jack. So when my husband and I are quarantined and there are a clergy couple to play You Don't Know Jack games via Zoom. Not quite always appropriate for kids, but some of them are okay if you're looking for engaging ways to do that.
Thank you.
Lots of games you can, you know, categories, you know, even Pictionary. There's a whiteboard feature that still is a lot, you know, you pull up someone who holds up the whiteboard screen and draws their picture and people get it.
Right. Oh, yeah. I'm familiar with those. Yeah. But with the ones you've got there, they look interesting.
The other thing, Olivia, I was going to add is just I don't know if any of you have done much with Jesse Tree. If you've ever heard of Jesse Tree, yes. It's about an 800-year-old thing. I mean, it's been goes back different ways, but basically it's kind of traces the story of creation to Christ through about 25, 24 ornaments. And this, yes, there are certain symbols that represent certain passages of scripture. But there's a book, and I'll put it in the chat, by Geraldine McClellan or something like that, called The Jesse Tree. And we and my family go through it every, for maybe a dozen years now. We've read this book, and it's sort of just from the first day of December, we just read it. And then we, you know, 1 year we painted ornaments for it. And then 1 year I actually, you know, you can create your own ornaments for people, or there are some out there that you can print out and have people use. But I think the nice thing about it is that it really brings that whole creation redemptive narrative all the way to Christ. And, you know, as you were all talking about that, I was thinking, you know, if we had kids in my church and we couldn't reach them because of COVID, an evening story, I mean, you know, they're like 10 minute chapters read aloud. I mean, even if someone was, you know, parents who don't want to buy the book, I bet if you, you know, you'd have a handful of folks who might tune in just for the story, but it walks you through each of those narratives.
Is it too long for children's moments in worship, each story?
You might be pushing it, and you wouldn't, and because you'd only get it once every, you know, you'd only get four of the stories. It's a narrative. It's a story about a little kid who goes into a church where a carpenter is carving a Jesse tree base and carving the animals into it. So, and basically the old man's grumpy, and they're just, it's a lovely story with wonderful illustrations. And cool. I mean, even my 19-year-old will still sit peaceably and listen to it because it's been part of our family tradition. But mm-hmm. It's something that I promoted as, in terms of all the Jesse Tree resources out there, it is, in my opinion, one of the best ones out there.
My
Geraldine, it's like a red covered book. I'll post it in here. Great.
Yeah, because church is doing it online, I mean, my practice, well, our practice, it's my husband's church now, I'm retired, but you know, even if there are no church in attendance on Zoom or in person, you know, that children's moment can be golden for everybody anyhow. So, you know, that sounds like a nice kind of comprehensive way to, but maybe shorten it or something, but I'll take a look. Thank you.
And I'll put that, I'm trying to find it here. I'll put the link. Someone put a link in there. That is not the link that it is, I believe. Let me make sure that one should take you there.
Are there any other questions or anything else you want to share? Sarah, what have you put together that's brilliant? I know you've put something brilliant together. I can see your brain working.
I don't think I have too much right now. I'm working on...
Celebrate that too.
Well, I think I don't have too much that's brilliant. I'm working on revising the article, and really, I was just trying to pare it down so that I give two or three options to families, and then I'll use the other ones in the future. We got the worship at home stories for our kids, and so I'm going to give those out with an Advent wreath for them to light, and I'm working on what a virtual children's pageant might look like. And St. Dustin's Church in Wisconsin is a church that loves drama and has a couple of different things they've done over the summer that I'm using to sort of check out what this could look like. I don't know their denomination, but they're super great.
We do the worship and wonder Christmas Eve with actual people. So we set it up. Yeah. You have the prophet and then you have the kids come up and then they just all move, which is lovely because if you can tell the story, they didn't have to pre-plan. The same people every year, it's now become a joke. The lambs and the donkey are always kind of festive to see. But we're talking about how can we make that Advent walk outside if we are closed down? What can we do visually outside? And there's some purple glow-in-the-dark candles on Oriental Trading that are also kind of interesting. They're like glow stick purple candles that I was like, oh, maybe we can use this for outside. But as we creatively try to figure that out, I have cold weather. Michelle Harris Glowier, I'm jealous of your outside. You could plan all sorts of things and it's beautiful. But so that, you know, I am brainstorming how this works, right, along with you, especially not knowing when it's coming and when it's not coming, and what my church will listen to and what they won't. But ultimately, I've been really proud of them because they're learning that worship is not just in one place. And I do, so that's actually where I kind of want to wrap up, unless anybody else has something they want to share. I would love to know, Jason, with all the work you've done, and we're in a pandemic, I have felt in our work that this has given some jump starts to some of the things that many of our churches needed to start to engage in, or at least force families to have more communication, have forced churches to think of things in a different way. And while that's not been easy for a lot of people, I have found more positive than negative, even though there are struggles along the way. But what has your experience been as you have your knowledge and your different experiences as we've gone through this pandemic? Like, what have you gone, oh, that actually works better in this and that doesn't?
Well, I think that going online for everything, if most of us have done some form of Zoom or Facebook or just live streaming, I think it sort of demystifies the consumeristic notion of church. We were consuming it in person, but now that we have to consume almost the exact same thing on a screen, the value of what we're seeing also is degraded. I think we'll come back from this and people won't want to go back into an embodied space because they never really wanted to be there to begin with. So I think we're going to see a paring down. I don't know if you, how many of you are familiar with Phyllis Tickle's book, The Great Emergence. But if you haven't read it, it's worthwhile reading. It's a jaunt through church history for the last 2000 years, but basically ultimately argues that we're in a sort of rummage sale of the church, deciding what we're going to be, who we're going to be, a lot, you know, and I think all of that was brought to home in this COVID pandemic, and also in the realization of what does it mean to be in embodied space? What does it mean to feel like a technologically assisted persecuted church? But what does it really mean to, you know, and what is even giving to the church mean when you're like, we're not even there and you're not running activities. So all of a sudden you feel like, you know, we've seen across the board giving going down because people feel like they aren't paying for services and pastors are exhausted because they don't know how to do, you know, and all that's to say is I think we're in a time of shift and change. I think the challenge of intergenerational work is that it centers on the life of the family mostly. In other words, like if you don't have within your small cluster, if you don't have intergenerational divisions there, you know, if it's a couple somewhere or someone who's, you know, empty nesters or people who are pensioners, they're just not facing those same intergenerational opportunities. But our parents in particular, I don't think have quite, you know, we farmed out this spiritual formation of our children to the church for so long that all of a sudden in the face of having to do it themselves, just like the homeschooling educationally, they're freaking out a little bit, but then, you know, I think what we're going to see is the value of who actually care about this stuff and who don't. So I think there is a benefit from this. I think there's a challenge too, just in what does it mean to be the church? There's a lot of research over the, and really not even just research, but just writing over the last two decades around what Robert Weber, who is a professor I had at Wheaton, called ancient future faith. I'm sure you've heard the idea that we're moving now away from modernity into more of an era akin to the early church, where, you know, authority is by smaller clusters of practice. And I think that we're going to see a revision or a revisioning of the church in intergenerational home churches. And so I think the challenge for us who do church as employment and work, because it's a threat, you know, it's a threat to our very livelihood, to some extent, but it does mean that as we move back from this COVID era, there's going to be a lot of people who just don't want to reconnect in the same way we did, or don't find the value out of it. And there will be those. And so I think it's kind of a rebuilding time. So I'm just rambling at this point. So I don't know if that answers your question or not.
No, that was great. I can see people's brains working, and that is what I love. Which means you should also take time to celebrate that you were being actively a part of what was a challenge, continues to be a challenge, but really creates a more faithful connection to knowing Christ and to knowing God. And no matter how many Zoom meetings we have, the work that you were doing is not immediate gratification work, but lifelong gratification. And that's important to remind ourselves. And that is countercultural, as John Roberto always reminds us, is that what we are doing is countercultural. And now we are living in this space where our culture is also shifting. So you need to celebrate all of the ability and space. And so much of it is just those little moments of making connections and also being willing to totally fail and celebrate that as well. You know, we're the high tech people, and I still go sideways on Facebook sometimes, you know, it's like, and that keeps it real. And I did notice, like, there are some people, especially boomers, who are trying to professionalize some of the things that keep things real in this process. So I encourage you, especially as we go through a lot of the emotions and stuff, as my daughter shows up, to keep it real, to keep all of it real. And so I'm going to change the light. Jason, thank you so much for popping into our crazy Zoom meeting.
Thanks for having me.
Someday when I finally get to travel again, we will go ski or hike or do something, because the majority of my family lives out there, and I'll hunt you down in the far mountains. Heather, we will be connecting soon. Maybe we will just Zoom out because of this virtual world and create space to have quality conversation with our youth and young people, that they can lead the way to have intergenerational conversation. All of you, you're amazing. And so I want just to remind you that the light that is in one place at one time is going to be in many places, from North Carolina to California to Oklahoma to Georgia to Indiana. I'm trying to think where all the rest of you, I mean, yeah, Emily, you're in Kentucky, you're near me. But to everyone, may you go and find the space that you need. And also, just please take care of yourself over the next week. If you have to turn off your phones, walk away, find some ice cream, apple cider, bourbon, I don't care, but do what you need to do to find your self-care. Hug your baby, Michelle, and I'll pretend to hug him too. Love you all. Have a great day, and bye.